This evening, we're privileged to hear from Seth Snyder on sustainable production and the impact of advanced biofuels and bioproducts. Seth received his BA from the University of Pennsylvania in Chemistry and Environmental Studies and earned his PhD in Biophysics from the University of Virginia. After working at Abbott Laboratory, Seth joined Argonne as the Associate Director of the Chemistry Division in 1998, and he currently works as the Section Leader of Process Technology Research at Argonne's Energy Systems Division. His team develops new process technologies ranging from tree growth to bioconversion technologies and product separations. The goal is to improve energy efficiency in production of biofuels and biobased products, CO2 capture and water treatment. In addition to this work, Seth serves as the president of the Council for Chemical Research. He teaches a graduate-level course at Northwestern University and is a senior fellow at the University of Chicago's Energy Policy Institute at Chicago, conveniently called EPIC. He has published over 50 papers in over 40 different journals, has 16 patents issued and pending, and has had his research presented at over 90 conferences in the past decade. He received the 2012 FLC Award for Excellence in Technology Transfer, three R&D 100 awards, and an Outstanding Mentor Award from the DOE FAST program. In the midst of it all, he has found time to serve as an early morning jazz DJ at Northwestern's WNUR. Please join me in welcoming Seth Snyder.
Can you hear me? Okay, thank you. I'm not going to talk about that stuff.
Well, I don't know. Well, what do you want me to talk about? Chicago is a great place for jazz.
It's a great place for jazz, and Hyde Park is. The Art Ensemble of Chicago started here in 1967 or so. I'm here to talk about biofuels and this. And we came up, Andy, I think we came up with this topic. You put me on this list like a year ago. And I said, whenever it was a long time ago, I totally forgot about it, and I made some other commitments, and then I realized that in the last minute, I was at the Gleacher Center at a workshop all day and had to come rushing down here. I'll talk about this. I am very flexible. You want to laugh at what I say, you want to interrupt me, that is fine. Let's make this a dialogue, because I have way more material to cover, and I know this is more of a public policy. I've got an engineering side into it, but actually I think one of the big drivers in success in renewable energy is the policy side of it. And that's something I'm on a learning curve. Jessica is helping me here. She's supporting a student, Asa, is going to be working with me on some policy questions. We're going to do it big time over the summer. And I know Mike Roth here has a lot of interest too. So I am going to talk about technology, but to me, the real big gaps are going to be in the policy side. I'm going to try to integrate that in as we talk, and hopefully you'll see that. And the policy drives the economics, which drives the innovation and technology, which drives the deployment. Feel free to contact me anytime. I'm right up the road, and I do respond to email very, very rapidly. And so this is the usual disclaimer stuff, which you could read if you want, but I'll just skip it. Argonne, how many people here have been to Argonne National Lab? Oh, so about a third of the audience. Argonne is about 25 miles southwest of here. We started right on the Hyde Park campus. A physicist by the name of Enrico Fermi, and so when you travel far away, I show on the map where that is. It's Argonne's right there, but it's about 25 miles southwest of here. We started off as working from the splitting of the atom, which went into us being peaceful use of nuclear energy, and we have basically expanded into a multi-purpose science and engineering lab with about a $700 million budget and about over 3,000 employees. We're very well known for the advanced photon source, which is North America's most brilliant X-ray source, and it's a process of upgrading. I work in lowly energy systems and transportation, which is very high profile on the outside, but doesn't actually make the picture. It's kind of right over there. We don't make the grade in the big photo shoot of Argonne. So this is what we do. I'll gladly talk if people have questions. I know a lot of people at Argonne. I can do introductions if you want. So what are we talking about today in terms of energy? And I know this is an energy series. So we'll talk about it here. There is a lot of sources of energy. And there's a few, and there's a lot of uses for energy, and it goes through a couple of pinch points. I mean, those pinch points are electricity, some stuff with heat and all, and then stuff with liquids. And so in biofuels part, we're talking about right here, but that's contributing into this petroleum sector. So most of this liquids will go into transportation. So this is where a take-home message, where there's a lot of interest in terms of displacement. Petroleum was seen as a huge barrier in terms of growing imports, and with changes in technologies and changes in use and electrification, our actual petroleum usage has started to decline. So the need for biomass, because we were going to run out of oil, which was talked about by Matthew Simmons a few years ago, or we're going to have to import till it crushes our economy, is not as much of a barrier. We are surviving with $100 a barrel oil right now. So there's other reasons why we may want to do it, and I'll discuss it as we go along. Electricity is fungible for different sort of things, but there's different values in liquids versus power, and I'll go into that. And we could have a nice debate about that if you want. The other thing that I think about a lot, and I was at Gleacher Center today, is water. When we think about energy, we have to think about water at the same time. And here's some of the reasons why. Our surface water use, our single largest use, is for thermoelectric power plant cooling. So when we talk about electricity, we are talking about water use here. So that's the single largest water withdrawal, and it winds up mostly in surface discharge, which may not change the quality that much, but it does change it some. And when we think about how we generate power, we have to think about how much water we use. The other big use of water is for agriculture. And so that is more of groundwater use, and some of it is surface. It's a mixture of two, and that is consumptive use. So when we use water for agriculture, we're actually consuming the water. Where the tie into energy and biofuels is a concern of how, if we expand agriculture, will that impact our water resources and how we're going to deploy that? So that's a big part of the work that we do, and then I'll talk a little bit about this evening. Is this called an afternoon or an evening talk, by the way? This evening? All right, because I'm usually at work till about 7 p.m. So where are we with energy? And I'm going to say something different than most people say over the next couple slides. We have, if we look back over the last generation or two, a steady growth in energy use, whether it's coal, it's oil, natural gas, nuclear, renewables. We see growth in all aspects of energy. And one of the things that's interesting about energy is that every single slide will use a different energy unit, and you have to learn to think internally. So when I teach in that, I actually always emphasize you have to be able to interchange energy. This is millions of tons of oil equivalent, which you can translate to barrels, which you can translate to BTUs, but essentially thinking about that is a good, valuable thing to do. So this is millions of tons of oil equivalent. Why we would do power on that? It doesn't really matter. It's just an interchangeable unit. So this is the driver. If you went not to a scientist, but you go to your next door neighbor, and this is something I discuss, when you talk about why we have investments in research, you have to be able to explain it to your next door neighbor. The first thing I know, if I speak to my mother about energy, the only thing that comes out is the price at the pump. And what they hear is the price of oil, and that's largely tied to the price of pump, but it isn't the exact same thing. And we look at different things, and we know we had a spike in 2008, and we have, we had a big drop then, and now we seemed over the last couple of years, I mean, this shows to 2012, but if we went out, we had some noise with the Arab Spring, but we're basically kind of in a range around $100 a barrel. And it may be a little up in a few percent, but it's essentially $100 a barrel, and that's after a long period of being relatively low in price. We have real versus nominal values, which doesn't make that much difference over this time frame. But let's look back historically what we have. So this is going back to the dawn of finding oil and starting to produce oil in Pennsylvania, going back to the Civil War. What we have, and this is in current dollars, I don't know what, 2012 dollars or whatever, and this would have been in money of the day, is that we see, this was a new, basically a lot of innovation, new field. We had a lot of noise here, but we had essentially a century-long stability in oil prices. We had spikes around wars and things like that until we came to this point here. And this is where we had the 73 oil embargo, which had to do with wars with Israel, and then we had the 79 oil embargo having to do with the Shah of Iran. That caused a spike, and except for what was new, that caused the highest prices ever in oil. We had some changes, and we had some investments and all, and we saw a stabilization of price going down very low again versus here, and once again, we forget about oil. So at this point in time, which was when I got my driver's license at first, we all knew that we couldn't afford oil. I remember when I started driving, I had to, an hour's worth of work, I could maybe drive 20 miles, which is how you have to think about it. And now I could drive a little bit more than 20 miles on an hour's worth of work. But that was, you know, where we were at that point in time. So we saw changes in efficiency and all. Prices came down for a variety of reasons. And it basically then spiked up. This was towards you know, the 2007 period when we had the craziness in the economy, but it hasn't come back down from now. So what do I see as issues here is that we have actually a diversification of sources and a diversification of use. This is, we're really at a point with oil that it is a fungible commodity. You can produce oil just about any place in the world. You can then transport it to just about any place in the world. So we now have a really globalized economy, which means that this price, I'm not an economist, but it doesn't seem to be as sensitive to shocks as once was. So this seems to be the real price, at least for now. With the Arab Spring, we see little spikes, but we go right back into that kind of $100 barrel range. So what does this matter, though, in terms of what I say, why I say it's not a crisis issue? What if we look at it in terms of GDP versus energy use, in every sort of image you see this in every country, GDP goes up faster than energy use. And so what is that is telling us in terms of energy use, we're getting more efficient, we're getting more GDP out of any unit of energy. So we are not getting more dependent on energy, we're getting less dependent on energy in terms of our economic growth. This is the US, it's even more so in a country that is rapidly developing, is that they are getting much, much more efficient in that. And we can reverse the curves and look at oil equivalent per se of GDP, and you can get those numbers. But essentially, we are getting more efficient in energy use there. So what is that telling me? I'm here to talk about biofuels. It's saying it's not needed. Is that we should just go home. But I think I have more of a story to tell than that. So to me, the message is not that we are running out of oil, which because we are discovering it because of technology in more and more places, and it's not that we can't afford it because it's getting more affordable. What I think the real message is some of the environmental impacts of oil and of fossil fuels and things like that, the environmental side, I mean, are cumulative versus some of the, although we're getting more efficient, the impact of them are getting cumulative, and that's really where I focus my work and why I still work in the space that I work in. So kind of what I'm saying is that oil production utilization is increasing, but not as fast as GDP, and so we're really becoming less dependent on oil rather than more dependent on oil. We've seen up high prices, and we see volatility based on economics, on what happens, you know, basically in the social world. And I know I say this, and I don't think a whole lot of other people say it. I feel we're getting less dependent on oil, and people just give me, I mean, beat on me. I don't care, but that's how I see the world. So why am I here talking about biofuels? Why liquid fuels, first of all? We know Argonne and University of Chicago and Northwestern Lodge, we have a huge investment in electrification. And that is focused partially on electrification to basically use power rather than hydrocarbons to produce mobility. That says we don't need biofuels. And I'm saying actually liquid fuels serve many needs, especially transportation, that are different than power. They are energy dense. So if you go to the gas station, you could put approximately 10 gallons of gasoline into your vehicle in 1 minute, more or less. I don't know, that's close enough. 10 gallons in 1 minute, a gallon has over 100,000 BTUs. That's essentially the equivalent of like a 10 megawatt pipe. Liquid fuels are energy dense. That gives them the a sort of flexibility to do things. So although we know and we hear a lot about the advantages of electrification, there's an energy density to liquids that is never going to be really fully achieved through electricity and battery storage and energy. So that is one thing, and I think that's a very important thing. It's funny when students come to me, well, what's the best battery material? What would you store it as? What are the molecules? And I said I'd install it in molecules that basically have carbon-carbon bonds with some hydrogens on them. I mean, that's nature picked that. They put energy under the ground, and it stays there for hundreds of millions of years. It's all in carbon-carbon bonds with hydrogen stuck to it, because that is both dense and stable. I mean, nature told us what to do. We just have to figure out how to do it sustainably. Liquids are easy to transport. I've never done this calculation, but you could look at a supertanker. You could put a liquid fuel on one point of the world, and for very, very tiny fractions of energy, you could just say transport anywhere else in the world, and you can use it there. So you can transport it across oceans. You could put pipelines, and we pipeline liquid fuels across huge regions of things. And I know there's a lot of issues right now with just, say, the Keystone pipeline and all. But essentially, pipelines are a very, very both energy efficient and resource efficient and safe way to transport energy. And it's actually much cheaper to do. When we start talking about the amount of energy that moves down a pipeline versus just, say, doing it through a power grid, the investment's going to be much, much lower. They're easy to store. How many people here have cars? Well, sometimes a lot of students don't. You go on vacation, you have fuel in your tank, it's just there. I mean, it's just there. Storage with liquid fuels is not an issue. I mean, over months, it may be hydroscopic bringing water, but essentially, you have a ultimately stable, dense fuel that's easy to transport, which is why I think we will not move away from liquid fuels anytime soon. I'll talk a little bit later about aviation. That's an obvious example where we're not going to see electrification. So that's why I think liquid fuels are important. Why biofuels, bioenergy? It could be the question of energy security is becoming less and less so. We have less, basically, a dependence on importing oil. But if by sourcing it locally, and almost all biofuels, bioenergy is sourced locally, it gives you the opportunity to basically for local economic development, which I mentioned here, and would include both a rural economic development and the refining capacity is regional in terms of manufacturing jobs. So that's one thing. I'm emphasizing less the energy security because I think that's not a much issue. It is a local economic development, and there's strong potential benefits in terms of environment. One of them, which I will highlight, is greenhouse gases. I will talk later on the work we do at Argonne and how that shows what the impact is on greenhouse gas emissions. I'll skip this. There's a lot of things necessary to succeed in that. So let's talk, what is the state of the policy? And this is something you guys probably know better than me, but this is where I'm always on a learning curve. We passed in 2007 a law called ESA, Energy Independent Security Act of 2007. George Bush was the president. He signed it. It was passed overwhelmingly by Congress, which was Democratic at that time, both houses were. And part of that was a renewable fuel standard. And this was the ultimate Venn diagram, sausage, whatever you want. And at the end of the day, when it was passed, nobody really knew what it said or why it said it. I've actually had discussions with people. One of the reasons we have all these different flavors was there actually a certain venture capitalist were in Nancy Pelosi's district, and they wanted the opportunity to build multiple businesses. And so they created all these flavors of biofuels so that they had multiple companies that go forward. I know who specifically the venture capitalist I mentioned, but I won't mention it there. And that person did give big donation to Nancy Pelosi when she was the Speaker of the House. We have within here a total, the law says by the year 2022, 36 billion gallons of biofuels. Of that, 15 billion gallons conventional, and that is no problem. We have 16 billion gallons of cellulosic, and I will describe what this is. We have 21 billion gallons of advanced, and cellulosic can qualify for advanced. And within that, we have 1 billion gallons of biomass diesel. And that qualifies for advanced but doesn't qualify for cellulosic. So we have all these different flavors. These are all are driven and are mandated as renewable fuel obligations that go through something called RINs, renewable identification numbers, which you track that you buy it. So it becomes a tradable commodity to meet a mandate requirement. I removed it here because it's so meaningless. Now, there was a trace basically from the law what the growth of each one is starting in 2007 going up to 2022. But basically, EPA has just made complete sausage of what those mandate levels are. So it's meaningless to put up what the law originally said. So what is the status? Conventional ethanol, which is what we think of as biofuels to most people, which is cornstarch to ethanol, started in the early 2000s from a variety of things, because we actually had a substantial tax credit, 54 cents a gallon. And we wound up with a lot of investments, a lot of companies starting off, a lot of farmer cooperatives. The U.S. has always exceeded those production mandates. So even though we had a mandate in there from the earlier law called EPACT, and then we had a later one, EASA, we've always exceeded that. So those last, you know, gallons were being sold without any mandate. So there was an economic reason for that. The advanced biofuels we have been achieving, and we've been achieving it not how they expected it. The advanced biofuels have been met by two reasons. Biomass diesel, which actually is a valuable fuel. I don't think I'll talk about it now, but I could. And the other way we've been meeting it is by importing sugarcane ethanol. Starch ethanol does not qualify as an advanced biofuel, but sugarcane ethanol does. And this is the funny sausage of making these laws. One of the reasons sugarcane ethanol qualifies is because the law says starch ethanol can't be advanced. The other reason is that the life cycle greenhouse gas emissions of sugarcane ethanol actually meet the requirement of 50% reduction. And what happens is, on the West Coast, we are a net importer of sugarcane ethanol, which qualifies an advanced biofuel, but because we import it from Brazil, Brazil has an ethanol need, we are a net exporter of starch ethanol to Brazil. And so we have a swap to meet a law and all, and if you start adding the life cycle for the transport, I don't know that it would make it, but that's how we meet the law. We've continuously had issues with cellulosic biofuel mandates. We have never come close to achieving those. And I don't remember what the exact law was for 2014. It was either like 1 or 1.25 billion gallons was what the law says. And the last I checked, I think it was reduced from that to 18 million gallons. And so we have a huge, basically, disconnect there. So what has happened there is that we've had, after that law, and even the couple of years before, either from federal research, national labs, universities, land-grant universities, we had a lot of activity in technology, whether it's fermentation, separations, catalysts. We had research across the field. We wound up with hundreds of startup companies, all going for angel and seed rounds, and we had a number of the companies. We had about maybe 15 companies go through an IPO, so we had a public offering. So we had a number of companies get launched. But none of them have gone to scale like that. A couple at a small scale. So what has happened is that the technology really wasn't ready, and so we got people ahead of the curve. They couldn't hit performance targets. And so what has happened is if you go back to the wording of RFS, the EPA is mandated every fall to look and say, not the law says 1.25 billion gallons, what do we expect the capacity, production capacity to be? And so they look, in November 2013, and they say the capacity for 2014 will be $18 million. They lower that investment, that mandate from 1.25 billion to 18 million. And what happens is the companies that are trying to deploy the technology, they have to get capital. They know they have an above market price for a product. They can't get into the market because they have an above unless they have the mandate there. And so they, without the mandate, they won't be able to essentially sell into the market. So they can't get financing to build plants. So we have a chicken and egg where each year we have coming in, we have companies that have they have technology that will be above market price, but it's not, but they can't get financing because the only way they do it is to build against a mandate, and the mandate gets delayed every year. So it's a chicken and egg thing. And so one of the things that in all work we look at is how do we get over that hump? Do we have to say, all right, it takes 2 years to finance and build a plant. So we're going to say now in 2014, in 2017, it's going to be 2 billion or 1 billion gallons, and we're not going to change it. And then you basically have, you create the market and you can get the financing in. I don't know how to get that done, but that's a real big gap. So we have technologies out there, but no financing of refineries. The two that were built was, one was a company called INEOS Bio, which actually was a research rich, because it's a JV from a large company, INEOS, which is a large chemical company. And they built it on a technology called syngas fermentation, where they use waste to produce ethanol. It's at 6 million gallons. What's interesting about that technology is the big funder of the research, Department of Energy, essentially poo-pooed that route from the start and put almost no dollars into that. They put it into some other routes, cellulosic ethanol with enzymes and all, and they have not been commercialized, but the one they poo-pooed actually went to market. The other one is a company called Kior, and Kior uses, and I will talk about it later, a process called pyrolysis that actually takes biomass, it partially cooks it without much oxygen, and it creates like a liquid that's much closer to gasoline. It creates something called a biocrude. That was built in Mississippi, and the plan was essentially to transport their biocrude to the refineries in Houston. But they keep having performance problems, and they just sent this, oh, not in March, we're in March. In February, they had to shut down operations. They have to look back at their operations. So they went to market before they were ready, and their technology didn't work. So what has happened in 2014 is this: is besides the delaying in the cellulosic ethanol and or the cellulosic biofuel, is the EPA actually loaded for all things, for all fuels? And here's a real challenge, and this had a huge pushback. I did some discussions with the governor's biofuels council on this question. There was the industry had a huge pushback. I didn't have the numbers here. The U.S. uses approximately 130-something billion gallons of gasoline a year. We have a blend wall. If when you go to the pump, it's 10% ethanol. So that is a market for 13 billion gallons. We are currently, the mandate is 15 billion gallons. And so that is above that. The way we were supposed to achieve basically that gap was the deployment of E85 flex fuel vehicles and E85 fuel. And so we actually have a huge flex fuel market out there. GM and Ford, the domestic manufacturers have most of their cars, you know, have capabilities for flex fuel. And the difference in cost is something like $100 in a $20,000 vehicle. It's just some changes and some sensors in there. But we have almost no deployment of pumps for flex fuel. So even though you may have a vehicle for that, you don't have the opportunity to purchase it. And the few places that you do have it, the BTU difference, it's actually on a per mile driven, it's more expensive, the flex fuel. So the way we would go above that blend wall of 10% was with flex fuel, and that hasn't happened because we just haven't seen the oil industry deploy, you know, that higher blend ethanol. So there is now the actual ethanol industry and the farm industries are talking about an intermediate blends. The EPA passed a law they basically had a ruling that any vehicle 2001 and newer can use E15, 15% ethanol. But we're seeing almost no deployment of that. We are seeing a little bit of interest in that, and that's really farm co-ops and all, basically installing E15 higher blend ethanol in mostly farm areas. But that's not making up the difference. So where there was a big pushback is that when EPA made this law, I mean this ruling that they're going to lower it, they were said you were only supposed to change it based on production capacity, not on utilization capacity. And they basically said they lowered it because of utilization capacity when the production capacity is certainly there. So this may result in a drop in ethanol production, some reduction, some shutdown of plants. I don't know what's going to happen. They basically had a comment period, and they're in the final decision right now. Did I say that right, Asa? He's doing some analysis for me right now. So what is Argonne doing about this? So we'll talk first about sustainability analysis. Has anybody here heard of a life cycle tool called GREET? Jessica, do you use it? No, you just direct other people to do things, I know. So GREET is a tool which we'll talk about, and it's specifically for sustainability lifecycle analysis. It stands for greenhouse gas and regulated emissions with energy technologies. It's available at this website. If you actually Google the word GREET, this is the first word. This is the highest thing. It's so well known at this point in time that when you Google it, it's the first hit, and that's a common word. And we have over 20,000 registered users. It's an open source tool for doing life cycle analysis. You can go there, you can download it, you can put your own data in there, you can build your own modules. We have periodically have workshops, training workshops on using it. DOE, and a lot of, if you're going to submit a proposal and there's a life cycle component, you're supposed to run a life cycle analysis on this. So this is a kind of cartoon of this, and I'm going to give you one result in here. I don't want to go through a full talk on that. So what we do is that we define a system boundary. What is the inputs that are going into the process? So that would include fertilizer if we were going to grow farm and other energy inputs to growing the crop. Releases, nitrous is a greenhouse gas emitter. So what are the releases from that? What are changes in soil carbon? Basically the carbon in the soil as well, are we causing a land use change directly or indirectly? What is the efficiency? What is the energy inputs? What is the CO2 emissions during fermentation in the refinery process? What is the basically the emissions as we burn the fuel? And so we do a life cycle analysis over the overall process, and we compare different fuel systems. We assume things like average power. So if you need power at the plant, we can adjust it, but we use average, you know, regional power, whether it's coal versus nuclear in terms of CO2 emissions. We also do things like look where the crop is grown, so things like water inputs. And we look at vehicle efficiencies, and so how far you go on that. So that's the kind of thing we do here. And with 20,000 users, it's a very standard tool, and it's really become a very, very robust way to compare this. And it's used in multiple places to decide if we hit these requirements. So going back to here, what I forgot to mention here is to qualify as a conventional biofuel, you have to have a 20% reduction in life cycle greenhouse gases in comparison to gasoline. And that's the average gasoline. To qualify it as an advanced biofuel, you have to have a 50% reduction. To qualify as a cellulosic, you have to have a 60% reduction. And GREET is the tool used to determine that. So rather than going through a starch or conventional ethanol, I'm going to give you an example which is very interesting, is a pyrolysis process. Pyrolysis is basically a cooking of it to make something that will basically be, rather than ethanol, can be a hydrocarbon replacement. So we use a lot of lingo, and I'll go through this so you'll understand it. FR is forest residue, basically thinnings from forests. CS is corn stover, which is the part of the plant we don't use. So those are cellulosic sources. They're made of biomass and all. There's many ways you can think about when you do a life cycle analysis. And the two that we primarily look at is oil savings. So how much oil you displace is not the same as how much greenhouse gas emissions you avoid. So we have it in a unit. This is million, as I said, it's always different. Millions of BTUs versus per ton of biomass. So this means if we basically use some of the waste and all to generate power, we sell power to the grid. BC means we use some of the carbon waste of the process and we generate a material called biochar. Biochar is essentially, it smells like charcoal, like you do in a grill, but it's actually a material that's a good soil matter. It's good for holding water. It's high in carbon, high in nutrients. So it's almost like you could think of it as a byproduct after a forest fire restoring soils. So in pyrolysis, you can take those solids and reapply them to the soil, or you could essentially burn them to generate power. Within that, then there's other things. Biomass itself do we have chemists in the audience? Sorry, I think everything is chemistry. Biomass itself is at a high level is carbon, two hydrogens, and oxygen. That is essentially the high level look of what biomass is. Oil is carbon and two hydrogens. And so the challenge, the real difference between biomass and hydrocarbon fuels is getting the oxygen out. So if you take biomass and you bury it under the ground with no oxygen and you put it there for $100 million years, you know, the oxygen will evolve out through pressure and all. We're trying to do that in a couple minutes in a lab. So one way to do that is to essentially you need to replace the oxygen with hydrogen. So important part of thinking about this is where do we get the hydrogen from? We can get hydrogen from natural gas. This is an important part of the input. We can get it from the oil itself. So we could take some of that biomass and generate hydrogen and do that. So the, all these things make a difference. So without going through a lot of stuff, let's just compare using biochar, using corn stover, and what we see is if we take hydrogen from natural gas, we'll save, just say, 11 million BTUs of oil for a ton of biomass. For the same conditions, we generate biochar, we now only get 8 million BTUs if we use the oil itself for hydrogen. What is happening is that we're using some of the biomass to generate the hydrogen to get rid of the oxygen. So you have less oil displacement. So if your primary concern is using less oil, you don't want to use the actual biomass as the source of hydrogen. Let's look at this a different way. We're going to look at greenhouse gas emissions. Again, we use a lot of lingo and here, and I'll compare. First of all, gasoline and diesel here on the side. We see a blue and we see a pink. PTW and WTP. WTP is well to pump. How much greenhouse gas is involved in making the fuel? So that could be from growing the crop, the fertilizer, to processing it, the refinery, get it all the way to the pump where you're going to, as a customer, use it. The pumped and the pump to wheels is basically the greenhouse gas emissions from burning the fuel. When we take a fuel and we burn it, it releases the CO2. So we need to think of both. Anytime you burn, whether it's ethanol or hydrocarbons, it does release CO2. And it's almost the same if these are essentially gasoline displacements. So we see on each one of these, we get about, what is that, about almost 80,000 grams of CO2 per million BTUs, and that's relatively stable. But the difference now is in how we produce the fuel. So first of all, what I said was corn stover and biochar as an example. So if I do that, I have a negative greenhouse gas emissions. Where does that negative greenhouse gas emissions coming from? One is that this is a photosynthetic process, so it's absorbing sunlight. It's absorbing, not sunlight, but CO2 from the atmosphere. So that results in a negative CO2. The other thing is if we do something like biochar, it's actually applying some of the carbon back into the soil. So we wind up with a large negative in producing the fuel. If instead of doing biochar, if I burned it for power, I have a little less of a carbon benefit there. It's small, but it's real. The other thing to think of is this, is if I now use the hydrogen, this is using hydrogen from the natural gas. So we have part of this is that when we take the natural gas and produce hydrogen, we release CO2 in the reforming process. So that impacts basically the negative side of this. If I use a pyrolysis oil itself, it's actually, I am avoiding any fossil use here, so I see an even larger negative. What it comes down to, though, is not just what's the negative from producing it and what's the positive from burning it. What's that life cycle? Not well to pump or pump to wheels, but well to wheels, WTW. And that is shown as this orange in between. So what I am saying is this, that if I use hydrogen from natural gas, I will now basically release about 30,000 grams of CO2 for every million BTUs. And that is comparing to about 100,000 for just a conventional gasoline. So that's about a 70% reduction in greenhouse gas emissions by using a biofuel versus gasoline. What's important here is to qualify as a cellulosic biofuel, you're required to have 60% reduction. So this would qualify. If I then go and instead of using a fossil source for hydrogen, if I use the biomass itself, I have a penalty is that I get less fuel, but I essentially can get very close to zero net emissions, near zero greenhouse gas emissions. The production of the fuel basically reduces the CO2 about the same amount as burning it. So I can get very close to 100% reduction in greenhouse gas emissions using a biofuel with just say a pyrolysis process and basically using the bio source for the hydrogen. This suggests that this is the way to go. So one of the challenges with RFS2 is you just qualify. So a fuel that qualifies at 60% gets the same in terms of rent credits as something that had a 99 or 100% reduction. So there's no basically policy benefit to doing this in here. So this is really more where people will go. The natural gas at this point is cheap. You would go that you would qualify as a cellulosic fuel rather than going that route. So we have a policy that drives that in that case. So this is what Kiora is trying to do, but they've got capital, they built, they produced a little, but they've not been hitting production for a variety of technical reasons. So this is what is on the market, but it's not being successful yet. Questions, comments? No, I'm not. I'm saying the fossil inputs. It's the same process energy for. Yeah, I am saying that instead of using natural gas for hydrogen for the process and other process, you're using the biomass itself as for the process energy, and that decreases the overall displacement of oil because you're going to produce less fuel out of it.
What is the process energy?
I don't have that off the top of my head. Sorry. Elizabeth, you know where to look it up at Greet. Okay. Yeah. We have hundreds of technical reports, and my head is way too small to remember numbers.
Is there a particular biomass that's most efficient?
We are looking at that question. I don't have that answer at the top of my head. So commercially, corn stover is seen as very advantageous because we already have an industry in place that knows how to, that is at that field, so it doesn't create a new industry. We're not set up in terms of harvesting grain, so we'd have to do a separate pass. Forest residue is seen as non-compete in that. So there's benefits and disadvantages to all of them. I'll talk a moment about aviation biofuels, and that was supposed to be done off of, I forget the name of this, it's not canola, it starts with C, an oil seed, which I just forgot the name of. Pardon? Camelina. Camelina. It was supposed to be done off camelina, and they actually did it off, so United is going to buy aviation biofuels based on a HEFA process. They basically did the press release based on camelina, which was going to come from a couple global energy trust, but the size of the oil seeds for camelina is different than soybean, and they didn't have the technology to crush the seeds. They had such a large loss. So camelina is a very, very, everything says a sustainable crop. It's grown off-season. There's a lot of benefits to it, but they didn't have the processing for it. There's not enough of a market for it. So what actually, when United starts sourcing biosource aviation fuels, which is being done at LAX, they're going to actually use beef tallow because we know how to handle beef tallow.
I got a question. So you're trying to tell me, is there to go for paralysis, you're saying there's not administrative, a rule where we can't get the CO2 instead of going to natural gas, we can't go to the other side, but there's some sort of administrative?
No, what I am saying is this. We could do this, but what RFS2 says, to qualify as a cellulosic biofuel, you have to have a 60% reduction in CO2, life cycle greenhouse gas emissions. So it would include other things like N2O and all. And if that's so, there's a small mandate which is supposed to grow, and so you would create a market because of RFS that gets bartered through RINs, that this fuel would get one RIN just like this fuel would get one RIN. So this, you have low yield, but you get the same RINs. And so this is less, you know, economically, you would not do this at this point in time. And we don't have the policy. You can't just say something like this and take something conventional, blend it, and get two units that qualify at 60% reduction. So there's a challenge in the policy there. That's what I'm saying.
Then the CO2 savings, that would probably be a higher net CO2 savings than making biofuel out of it, trying to displace oil.
So that is something that's if it's basically a straight, what is the cheapest way to avoid greenhouse gas emissions?
Then you avoid the process energy, right? You're just going to burn it. It's 1-to-1 substitute for coal, but you're throwing it in a power plant, no process.
But we already have substitute for coal, which is rapidly scaled up, which is natural gas.
Sure.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. I mean, that's a good debate.
But I know that's not our incentive structure.
Yeah, there's, unless you have an RPS, which is state by state, it's not national, that doesn't happen.
And one day we're all electrified and we'll last and left somewhere.
Yes, and which is why I'm so engaged and want to learn so much from Harrison all. Because I did everything, every bit of training I ever had was in science. And everything that I do on a daily basis, really the policy drives whether I'm going to be successful or not. And so one of the things I teach a course, and I was there this morning at Northwestern, and it's in the McCormick School of Engineering, and I tell you have to engage the social science or you're going to waste your career. And so, I mean, I'm trying to sell that this is the right thing to do, and I'm on a learning curve. There are other things with that. It's not that simple. Corn stover is a direct replacement for coal, and that's all flying with discussion. That's fine. Coal is a brittle substance that's easy to crack, easy to crush. Corn stover is fibrous. You can't just, it would take capital investments to do a large scale displacement. And the other thing is coal with our infrastructure, it's collected very energy dense. Most power is done very centralized, whereas corn stover is very distributed. I didn't go into this. One of the advantages of pyrolysis is that it's not a very high pressure process. And when you have high pressure, that defines that you need, because with heat is heat, but with pressure, the amount of volume goes with a cube of the radius, whereas the amount of steel you buy goes with a square. And so anything with pressure is, the bigger it is, the cheaper it gets. And so things like, I don't talk about Fischer tropes, which is a high pressure process, really require very large economies of scale. Pyrolysis can scale down more efficiently, you know, when you don't have high pressure processes, but that's going way into the engineering details. And so some of the models that we have seen people doing is that you could almost go to almost like a preliminary pyrolysis that's distributed almost at the farm scale, or like at the farm co-op scale, and they're basically producing, you know, a somewhat stabilized liquid that can then be transported, you know, just say in tanker cars rather than in bales, you know, and that is a much more energy dense process. That's going way into the weeds, which is what we're talking about than I wanted to today. So biomass resources, you mentioned that we work on trees and all, so I'll talk a little bit about that a little. Now, unless people want to go on about life cycle analysis forever, which I really don't want to. So what are we talking about in biomass feedstocks? And so this question comes up a lot. Oak Ridge National Lab in Tennessee did a study. It was called a billion-ton study. A lot of us contributed to it. There's a lot of information on their knowledge discovery framework, bioenergykdf.net. You could register. You can access, you know, BOCO data there. They did this study, and they looked at ag residues, which is the corn stover, things like rice straw, energy crops, direct purpose-grown crops like switchgrass, miscanthus. They looked at wood, whether it's forest residues or urban residues, also basically purpose-grown wood. They've also done look at things like MSW, municipal solid waste. What is those residues here? It was called a billion-ton study because at the end of the day, that their estimate was that we can, on a sustainable basis, recover about 1.5 billion tons on an annual basis. 1.5 billion tons. That's strongly prices sensitive. So if you're willing to pay more for biomass, you can harvest more because some of it is more and more complicated to recover. You could look around, so it's different sources. So we have, you know, high wood in the northwest, and we have high wood here, a lot of wood here. This is more grasses and grain residues, you know, things like corn stover. So there's a lot of different things you can do. And what's important about this map, getting back to the policy, is when in the mid-2000s, the idea of biomass replacing oil, it got such good play in Congress, because virtually every senator saw that as a play for my own state, except for maybe, you know, there's a couple states in the Southwest, but everybody saw that as an opportunity. And this drove how we got to where we are, because it's considered widely distributed. This got filled in very quickly, starting in 2008, because the next big thing became algae as the solution, and a place to do that would be in the Southwest and the high sun areas of that. So everybody saw biomass as a way for local economic development. So what are we doing here? This is an actual field. I'll show in a moment actual trees. These trees are actually made of silicon, because it turns out we had in 2012 a very bad drought and we lost our crop. So we just etched in the trees right there. This is a site in central Illinois. It's about an hour and a half from here, which we are actually doing sustainable bioenergy crops. This is a productive corn, so this is corn for feed or animal feed, whatever it uses. And these are willow trees we planted. And we planted these trees for a couple of reasons. One, if you look, it's slightly downstream. If you look at the soil, it's very muddy soil. So what happens here is that the farm, we see a spot like that, is that the farmer plants where they get a lot of productivity. And behind this existing tree stand is a stream, is that we had a natural runoff. This is not irrigated corn. This is rain-fed corn, but it is fertilized. And when rain hits it, you have wash-off. So you had basically water coming here that's very high in fertilizer and nutrients. So we planted trees here and basically to look at the growth. I won't talk about this in a couple other places. What we know is that when we put it in the pathway of runoff, we see very productive growth. We did mapping of the site. We looked where the sites were. We were collecting a lot of nitrogen, and we planted based on there. We placed our crops where they're basically recovering land. The farmer didn't use those sites because it was too muddy. They really couldn't use their existing. It wasn't worth it for them to plant corn in spots like that. So we selected sites like that to do that. With that, what we see is that we have areas that are high bushel growth, on the order of 200 bushel per acre, which is Illinois corn, and areas that were very low, so they just wasn't worth it to plant this. So that's where we planted the willow trees. These are some of the willow trees coming in. We actually, they're coppice, they're sticks, and they're cut, and they're planted in like 6 or 12 inch lengths. We planted them in 2012, and we had the worst drought of who knows how long, and we lost that whole crop because this was another policy question. For the farmer to recover his insurance in the corn, he had to plow over the whole field, so he had to plow over our willows. So basically, the insurance made us lose the crop. We replanted in 2013, and we went very nicely into it, so now we have an established crop going on, and this is kind of how we plant them. They're planted like this. We are monitoring in this, and this is going to go for about 5 or 7 years. We're monitoring water quality, so we're looking at nitrous levels, other soils. We're looking at absorption. Okay, absorption of nutrients. We're looking at a lot of things looking at those crops. So this is really looking at the sustainability of the crops. We're doing GIS mapping where we can do it. I'll move on. I'm going to spend 5 minutes and go to Q&A. I'll talk about what we do in production. I mentioned aviation biofuels, and I think this is a nice example. I was part of a group, and Jessica was familiar with it, called MASB, Midwest Aviation Sustainable Biofuels Initiative. We had a team look together at different biofuel technologies, produce things to displace aviation. So we went through a series of about 30 ones. We looked at various intermediates. I'm just going to talk about one of them, and that's this process called HEFA, hydrotreating of fatty acids and esters. This is a commercial process, so it's ASTM approved. And HEFA biofuel can be flown in a commercial jet right now. So what we looked at was some of the economics of the process. We looked at the feedstock costs. We looked at capital plans. We looked at a variety of steps in the plus, the rate of return from the financing. And what we got to is that our costs were close to $2 above the costs that we could sell the jet fuel from. And so what we basically came out of this and says that we need about a $2 credit for this to get there. So this is where the RINs would play in, the renewable identification numbers to play in that. Ultimately, if you look at a variety of things, the actual cost of vegetable oils is the price on a per pound or per unit basis is essentially the same as the fuel. So even if all these costs were zero, we would not make the grade. So without a tax credit, and whether you want to do it or not, it's not going to, we're not going to see deployment. And so one of the challenges is when we see things like delays in RINs, in the RFS policy, a financer basically depreciates that value essentially to zero. So you can't say, I'm going to get it next year, because they have a working that, to them it'll be delayed. So this is not factored in when you go for financing, so plants are not getting financed. We looked at things like comparisons of prices of different feedstocks, and they track together. They're not, they don't diverge, they track together. I will skip that. Anyway, one thing I'll say here quickly is that we see pyrolysis as one of the best opportunities for doing that because we can use a range of feedstocks, and we believe that'll get over that gap. So that's what we kind of reported out from there. I will talk about one way we do pyrolysis, and then I'll close it out. So we are working specifically on pyrolysis, and I was doing some emails right before this started. In specific, one of the aspects of pyrolysis is a process called catalysis. Catalysis is where you take basically heterogeneous metals and you use that to drive reactions. And we have a system which we call atomic layer deposition that we can build nanoscale materials with specific chemistries, specific materials. So we're doing this where we build a catalyst and then we put a stabilizer, so we put a layer on this. So this gives an example of what they looked as an electron microscope, where we can look, we have structures in here, and it's the structure with the metals that provides the catalytic activity, how we basically cause reactions, which is what pyrolysis is, a chemical reaction. Without our technologies, these catalysts sinter. So essentially the heat and the oils and the explosion basically breaks them down. They lose their structure. With our technology, we're able to maintain structure. This is only 12 hours, but it's an example of that. And so this is kind of simulating what a pyrolytic reaction would be, and we're showing that all catalysts are going to be more stable. We've done economic analysis on that, and the critical thing in catalysts is what is the life of the catalyst? How long until it breaks down do you have to go offline and replace it? So we typically, in a commercial system, you look for about 12 months. Existing in places like Kiora, it's probably more like 1 to 2 months. And we did basically the additional cost of our process versus the avoided cost for changing out the catalyst. And what we saw, just say at 1 month, is that we would save about 64 cents a gallon based on our process. And we assume we double the life of the catalyst. So we think this is something worth doing, investing in this catalyst technology. We are talking with sponsors with DOE on further investments in this technology. We're doing many things like this. This is just one example. I want to bring it up because I brought up pyrolysis. I am going to skip biobased products because I was told I had enough time. But I will just say that what I think about, and this is just in closing up, feedstock energy, this is a good way to think about it. This is a colleague of mine from Dow. He basically put a chart on dollars per BTU. Dollars per million BTUs, natural gas is in this sort of range. From this one example, we make ethane to ethylene, so this is why we see ethylene production and polyethylene production. This is an investment, this is a return. Coal goes up and down, but coal is at the cost of natural gas on a BTU basis, but there's other impacts of why we see it declining. Crude oil is much higher in price, so on the order of $100 a barrel, or wherever this is, it's much more expensive than natural gas. But liquids are much more fungible. So this is why there's a huge arbitrage between oil and natural gas. Gasoline is basically the increase in value by cleaning up and converting it. Biomass itself is seen as somewhere around 100, this is showing a little low, on the order of $100 a ton. On a BTU basis, it's very inexpensive, but that conversion cost to make gasoline is still very high. There's still a lot of risk there. Ethanol is basically cheaper at current prices than gasoline. So even though it's showing up here, it's a little bit lower. Ethanol is a little cheaper than gasoline, but there's a difference in BTU contents. Corn is much more expensive from biomass, but we know how to do this, so this is a transition we see. And this is where we're going to in terms of the bioenergy program. And as a comparison, this is a little high for this area, but power is really down around here. So it's power is similar to things like gasoline in terms of cost per BTU. But I argue that the advantages of liquids will make the liquid stay around for a long time. I'll skip that. And my take-home message is, I didn't talk about it, but bio-based products, which is everything around the fuels, which is things like plastic solvents, a much higher margin. They offer substantial GHG similar to cellulosics in there. There is advantages in terms of going after bio-based products because of the higher value of the product you could build into a market. When we think about sustainability, we really have to think about those feedstocks. That's the driving force. The economics are driven both by the feedstocks, which has a very large impact on cost, and that's why we're going towards biomass. The conversion costs are largely driven by the capital investment and the uncertainty there, which gives you, it's basically capital becomes very expensive. My focus is on those higher margin, small volume products where we could sell into a market. We're not competing directly against gasoline. With uncertainty in RINs and RFS, we basically have to compete just on an economic basis without that mandate. Success is really going to require a strong and consistent policy, which we have not experienced to date. It's always a moving target, and that's going to remain a challenge to a deployment like this. So that's my little short story.
Are you saying that the corn is being grown on land that could not be used for food?
I did not say that. The corn is in the productive agriculture, and all. Corn, a number of acres for corn is relatively constant over the last couple of years. I am saying all work is looking, edging productive agriculture fields into the unproductive, that what's called the marginal lands. So if you go to the productive areas, there is unproductive regions, but there's still a lot of nutrients there. And we are focused on doing on using the unproductive land.
It's
going to be nitrogen, phosphorus, and you know, potassium, the usual. We are not adding extra. I think we added some fertilizer when originally planted the plants, but no, the idea is that they live off the runoff from the productive, from the existing agriculture. By the way, I've never saw her before, but I see her every single day on LinkedIn, and I recognize her in the hall.
This was an excellent presentation. I was curious, the conversion costs are largely driven by capital. How is it that hydrocracking is more advantageous over biofuels in terms of capital?
There's a lot of reasons. So why is so we are basically doing similar technologies, you know, in oil as we are in biomass. First of all, it's a little bit more for biomass because we have the oxygen. So we're going from basically crude oil to gasoline. Molecularly, is almost the same. Second of all, we are talking about very, very large scale because oil is collected in very large scale. So you have huge economies of scale. Some of the reactions are high pressure, you know, when we're doing, you know, certain aspects of it. And some of it is depreciated capital that we have very mature, you know, systems. There's a variety of reasons. Could biomass get to the point where it's as capital efficient as oil? That'll take you. I mean, we got to where we are in oil. It took a century. You know, I think we could do it quicker in biomass, but we have to move down that curve. And you, if you keep delaying, we're not moving down the curve.
What product that you're focusing on is the higher margin and the smaller?
What products? Yes, I ran out of time in talking about that. So I will show you that. So we're working, one of the things we're working on is a way to do a fermentation and recovery of product. The primary class I'm going after is called organic acids. Organic acids, citric acid is used in foods. Lactic acid, this is made of lactic acid, this cup. Most others are made of polyethylene. These little cups that you see like this and you see the little green logo, that's made from polylactic acid. That's a fermentation of a sugar to produce lactic acid, which is a natural product. When we run too hard anaerobically, we produce lactic acid. With efficient production technology, we're able to do it cheap enough to compete. These are a little above margin in terms of price, but something like this. Succinic acid, there's a lot of interest. There's a couple of companies going commercial right now on that, and that is seen as a replacement for nylon. Right now I submitted yesterday a proposal. There's a form of propionic acid that could be converted to make carbon fiber. So right now, Boeing makes a big part of the jet with carbon fiber. We would love to do a mobile fleet, a ground fleet with that, because it would significantly reduce the weight and then improve performance, but we can't get carbon fiber at cost. So propionic acid is a potential stepping stone to get to cheap carbon fiber, which would basically lightweight vehicles. That won't happen for a decade. Lactic acid is on the market already. Acetic acid is used for making a lot of, so that's a 20 billion pound per year market. So these are markets that are a few percent of the oil market, but on a per pound basis, they sell much higher. Acetic acid is a mature market that's made from natural gas, so then you'd have to compete on market prices. The succinic route, there is no good way to make it, cheap way to make it from a petroleum or a natural gas route. So that is moving into a new market. So that gives you the opportunity. Products like this will sell closer to $1 a pound rather than if a gallon of fuel oil is just say 7 pounds and it sells for $3, the fuels are selling at 30 or 40 cents a pound, and these are closer to $1 a pound. So that's that margin gives you the opportunity, you know, to basically be, you know, recover capital and be successful. But these are much smaller markets.
How much capital requirements are you talking about for that?
That depends on the size and things like that. We've done some numbers on the order to a company, Myrant, out of Massachusetts, just went commercial with succinic acid, and that's a 30 million pound per year plant, which would be a drop in the bucket as a fuel. And they are probably, I would say, probably about $1 or so per pound of capacity. That's a reasonable number. So that's probably took a $30 million investment. They did get a subsidy, so that was through the Recovery Act. That was partially funded by Department of Energy through a grant, not a loan guarantee. And with that in place, and basically there's risk and technology. I mean, they're not a public company, so they probably have both debt and equity. It's going to be relatively high risk debt because there's a risk on technology and markets, but the equity, you know, would be, I don't think it was even, I think they could, I don't know how they do it. They could probably close enough to do an venture level, which would want a high percentage, not basically a capital finance, which would want higher, you know, which would want better known returns. Other questions?
Earlier you mentioned something about having a co-op in rural areas to do the refining process in that area and export it out.
Yes.
Could this be something that is more helpful towards something, towards those areas that have been hardest hit because of the recent recession?
That's good. That's way above, you know, I've never done things, how do you basically figure out how many jobs to create? It could be, yeah. So what you're doing at the highest level, you think about it, is you're increasing the export value from your region of that product. You know, biomass, you know, as a raw number, I say is $100 a ton. That bio crude, if you think about it, it's going to be a little bit lower, unless we have a RINs in there, it will be a little bit lower value than crude oil because it has a higher oxygen content. But you could think basically a barrel of oil, which, you know, is 42 gallons, is going to be worth $100 versus a ton of biomass, which would be worth $100. And a ton of biomass would probably make more like 70 gallons. So it's going to make about a barrel and a half. And so you're doing some upgrading there. I don't know how to work out in my head what those economic value is. So you're creating value there. And the advantage is because it's without needing high pressure, it can be done distributed. And there's some advantages is that the economic advantages is you're avoiding the transport of that low density material. Transport of low density, low energy materials is not efficient. You're increasing the density, and so you're increasing the value. I want one from Jorge. This guy, he's a student I worked a little bit. I think he's a very sharp guy. He only has the answer, sorry. No questions. All right, sorry. Anybody else?
One quick one then. You skimmed over algae, but I saw a company making bio crude for algae. I don't know.
I can give a two-hour talk on algae, but that's going down the hall. So yes, so without going into anything on algae, there's two routes that people are thinking about with algae. What most people think about a high-level algae is autotrophic algae. Algae that basically absorbs sunlight and CO2 and produces lipids. So when we think of algae, that's what we think of when we say it's going to be sustainable and all. Algae is sold as an advantage because basically photosynthetically, it's much more productive per unit of land area. So you can produce much more liquids per unit of land area. There are a number of challenges with algae, and there's a lot of companies working on them. And some of them has to do with if you have something that's very photosynthetically efficient, you basically can get like that skim layer. If you think of a pond, and all the photosynthetic efficiency is just in the first couple, you know, centimeters. And so you basically have everything below that is unproductive. So everybody who's going to a productive algae system has to actually put pumping systems in and rotating systems. So it's not just like an open natural pond. They're creating artificial ponds, and they're creating circulation systems, and the actual energy of that circulating the water is actually real. The other part of that is that the actual lipids in there, in the algae cell, are relatively concentrated, but the algae cells within the water are very dilute. So you have a huge cost and energy problem for separating the water from the algae. So there's a lot of people working on that, and my group is working on that particular question. We're not actually growing algae ponds and all, so we interact. So that's a question. So there's a number of steps in the way that make the cost very high. There's a couple companies that actually have contracts with the Navy selling algae. There's Solarzyme, as an example. They're doing something different. They're not doing autotrophic algae. They're doing heterotrophic algae. What do I mean by heterotrophic algae? These are bugs just like any other bugs, and they're actually feeding them sugars. And the algae is very efficient at converting sugars to lipids. You get over some of the challenges with moving your access to sunlight, because you could just do them in a fermenter. You also can get much higher density that way, you know, up to like 50% oil versus, you know, an autotrophic or sunlight-driven process. And so what we see selling out is basically heterotrophic algae. But the questions of avoiding using biomass land to produce sugars is still in place. They still have to produce the sugars. They are doing that because there's a contract. The Navy wants to build the market, so they're buying the fuels at above market price, something like 3 or 4 times market price. But they're doing that almost like a reverse. Even it's a contract, a reverse auction to create a market there. So the Navy is paying to help advance the technology by buying the product. There are some other challenges in there. We did some design work. So one of the big selling points on algae, autotrophic, was that we were going to source CO2 from power plants to use to create the algae. And that actually is a very big challenge because they're not co-located. You need sunlight, you need land, you need water, and then you need CO2. And transporting CO2 over long distances it is energy intensive and expensive, and there was a variety of issues. So the price point for algae are still very far away, and I think they will stay far away for a while.